Fantastic. Welcome, folks. This is Kubernetes 1.30 mid-cycle retro. So every release we have two to three retro. So this is the first. We will definitely have another one towards the end. But essentially, this is the space where we come together and see what we do well and what we can improve on. As always, this meeting is under the CNCF Code of Conduct. So please continue to be kind and considerate for each other. So I do have some action item that is left over from previous releases. This is the board that I will have to update later, but let's look at where is my things. Okay. Awesome. So these are the follow-up. I'm just gonna run through these really quickly. We're gonna talk about what went well, what could be better, and what we will do differently. And while we're doing that, I'm gonna add to this action item column at the bottom there. So first thing first, follow up when to freeze kept templates and how to communicate changes and automate versioning. Mark is owning this. Mark, are you here? And if there's any update, I believe this conversation is also important for our enhancement freeze. Folks have been asking questions about whether they need to file exceptions due to kept changes. If Mark is not here, I'd love to follow up with him later. Okay. This is James. Action item. We a couple releases ago received feedback from Shadows about the fact it was maybe a little confusing which communication channel to use, and we haven't done anything about it since, and James is not doesn't have the time to be super active in the project anymore. So I talked to him. We might potentially cancel this action item unless folks think it's still helpful. So if you're a Shadow here and you think that the different channels of communication that we use, that is email, Slack, GitHub, is confusing. Let me know and I'll keep it up. Otherwise, I think I will probably cancel it because we don't have folks to work on it.
I think one quick
Oh,
point on that one is
yeah.
that typically, at least in my experience, we don't use the release dash channels very often. I feel like a lot of it ends up being in like small group Slack channels. So for example, like in enhancements right now, we very infrequently use the release dash enhancement Slack channel and very frequently use our little, enhancement squad direct messages. I think that we don't necessarily need to put everything out into the open, but it would be nice to have some more guidance about what the direct or what the preferred method of communication is.
I think the general approach to that is you should make as many things public as possible, but that channel also serve as like a landing point for the public when it comes to like enhancement freeze and code freeze, if I do see what you're saying. Let me circle back with James on this and see what that would look like. Okay. Cool. Next up, I own this. Update the webinar format. This is the change in the webinar where we don't go through every single enhancement anymore and just go through the major themes, and I haven't done it yet. I will get on it. Next, we have enhancement board automation previously assigned to Priyanka. Priyanka told me that Shreeram is working on this. Shreeram, are you here? What is going on?
Yeah, so last week we had a call with in the enhancement sub-project called Prusik Architecture. We had discussed general stuff related to KEPS and the automation. Like basically the main discussion was about versioning the KEPS so that the work of the enhancements team is easier. And we had also discussed the automation there. Yeah, I'll follow up with the enhancement support team, basically Kristen and Kat.
Okay, so it sounds like you're doing the board automation and also the kept versioning with Mark. Is that right?
So I was present in the call, but I'm not sure how this like how owning this issue works.
Hmm.
That maybe you can add.
Could you please follow up with Mark on like look at this issue and follow up with Mark on like kept templates and versioning?
Yep, I know.
Okay, fantastic. And then we got two things that are done applying the process for removing releasing folks who are unresponsive and aligning milestones. That is all good. All right, what went well in 1.30, Kristen? Would you like to share your good news?
Sure. I just want to call out that the comms team's outreach to CAP owners on the GitHub issues was successful in that it yielded 17 placeholder PRs, and that's both a good thing and a bad thing. It's good because people were very responsive, and it's sort of bad because it means a lot of work for us potentially get tracking down reviewers and that sort of thing. But in general, it's a net good.
Yes, very exciting. We're gonna have lots of blocks to look at. Cat enhancement freeze. What's up with that?
Hello. We had a really high hit rate with enhancements freeze. There were like 85 cats total, and 66 of them made it through enhancements freeze. We will almost certainly have some of these drop off at code freeze next week, but still, that is an incredible hit rate. So, really good work to the enhancement sub team for bullying everybody into getting things done on time.
For sure. Drew, you have a couple things to celebrate here.
Oh, Drew is not in this meeting. Drew had a conflict. So
okay.
put in nice things, but had a conflict with actually making it to the meeting.
No worries. I will read them out. Drew has put down that the docs outreach has yielded 65 placeholder PRs, which is a lot out of 66 active KEPs. Folks are doing really well. It looks like the team is really thriving as well. And special thanks to Viom for going above and beyond in covering task. Seems like Drew also created a slide deck for orientation that simplified what was in the handbook, but it was well received. It was really cool. And Drew and Viom created a Google Calendar for the doc sub team with email reminders on the upcoming deadlines. That's very cool. Always cool to see what the individual sub teams are doing and what works for them.
Yeah, super helpful.
Yeah. Cool. Let's talk about what could have gone better in 1.30. Before I do that, can I have a volunteer note taker? Because the conversation is going to go so fast.
Yeah, I'll take notes.
Thank you, Kat.
You're so welcome.
All right, Nigel, would you like to share what you put down here?
Yeah, just a quick one. The mandatory orientation meeting felt like it kind of came out of nowhere. And so if we have meetings that we're expecting everybody to go to, like a little bit more lead time, if possible, would be very appreciated.
That's on me. Yeah, noted. Let me think. Orientation was the second week of the release. Okay. Mickey, you have a comment here about
Yeah, so
request.
Kat's already aware of this one, and she
yeah.
helps sort of go to bat for us. But after the enhancements freeze, or the freeze party, we got some feedback from some of the enhancements owners that in some cases wasn't particularly nice. I think what we can do to improve things is to take the code freeze party enhancement templates that we already have that exist and try to soften some of the language there. And also just make it very clear that just because an enhancement is, missed the code freeze cut line doesn't mean that everything is over. That's like people can still come in and get exceptions. So they're not completely out of the release cycle.
Does anyone have any thoughts on this?
There was a small change. I'll add notes for myself after I'm done talking. There was a small change made to the documentation as a direct result of one of these issues already that clarifies if a deadline is missed for enhancements freeze as a result of what could be considered a clerical error, such as forgetting a tag. That may not necessarily require an entire exception request and to ask in the release enhancements channel. Because we did allow one through without an exception request because it was just a missing tag. And the answer is ask the enhancements lead. So that is codified now.
Thank you for doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And then the one below is very similar. I know that Grace on the release team call today had brought up the importance of soliciting preemptive exceptions for code freeze. So I was just thinking that that's another area where we can just update the language that's in the templates that exist within the enhancements documentation to just call out that if folks know that they're going to need more time, they can let us know ahead of time so that there's not a mad scramble on the day of code freeze.
So it seems like we have, I'm trying to untangle what action items we have here.
I think
I
the
will
action
say,
items. Okay, I was just going to say the action item, I think, is really just changing the templates, just updating them to make the language a little bit clearer and a little bit softer.
Okay. Yeah, I was going to say we can do that, but also like the language wasn't the problem. In terms of what happened there. So we can update the language for the part where we remove enhancement from the release and also solicit preemptive exception for code freeze. Can I get an owner on that?
I'll do it. We also, when we added the docs freeze, that documentation about the docs freeze does include asking for like preemptive exception requests. So there's no reason why we couldn't do that consistently across all freeze deadlines.
Okay. Fantastic.
And Kat, I can help you with that if needed.
Absolutely. Let's do it.
Okay. Kat, the next one is yours.
Yeah. So this caused a lot of problems, cascading problems for multiple teams and contributors. But we were explicitly told by SIG release leadership to ensure that all CAP owners answered the new PRR question. It is not optional. They need to answer it. It's my opinion that these KEPs should not have received PRR approval in the first place with that question missing. So that is an oversight of the PRR team. I've already gone and talked to them and there needs to be some work done there, but ultimately this is a problem that would be solved by the versioning of KEP templates. What's up, Mark?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think I know where this conversation's going.
Yeah, buddy. How you doing?
Good.
Good?
Yep.
Do you want to, you don't have to work on this if you don't want to. We did rope a couple more people into it in a meeting with the PRR team. But this is a thing we want. We actually want to work on this because it causes too many problems.
Okay, yeah, good. Yeah, I'm happy to help. I think before I was just kind of stuck because I was trying to get SIG architecture to sign off and there was some lukewarm kind of reception to that. But if it seems like it is causing a lot more pain, I think we should just go for it.
Yeah, it's causing a lot more pain. I took it to SIG Arch and they agree that this is something that should be resolved.
Okay.
But also that awesome. I don't think that any of these KEPs should have gotten PRR approval with that question blank. So it's an issue for them and for us.
Okay. Yeah. Loop me into that. I wasn't aware that that went back to SIG architecture.
Cool. Will do.
Awesome.
Okay. Sriram.
Yeah. So I have the announcement email that we sent to the Kubernetes dev channel announcing that we are accepting enhancements for the 1.30 release. And in the email, we mentioned that all enhancements should plan to opt in well before the production readiness review freeze. And the enhancements opted in after this deadline would be at risk for inclusion in the release. So like my point here was that we get KEPs in sort of waves, and the enhancements team like towards the like as we approach the enhancements freeze date, the KEPs that were added the last would have the least amount of time between the enhancement shadows reaching out to the KEP authors and the actual enhancements freeze date. So I don't know a solution for this. Like this is directly like tied to the like the versioning, the KEP versioning, KEP template versioning issue. So if that process is made faster, the enhancements team can go through the entire list of KEPs faster, and the authors would have more time to address those issues, enhancements freeze. But then yeah, basically the issue is we don't have a deadline, and we end up sort of treating the enhancements freeze as the deadline to reach out to the KEP authors, and like they need some amount of time before the enhancements freeze so that they can like reach out to us what the status of the KEP is. So, Mohammed, I
okay.
think you might have something to add.
Mohammed?
No, I don't have any, but I think the next item that I wrote is somehow similar, that we might need to add a soft deadline for exceptions that we are getting. We received an exception about a week after enhancement freeze. So should we put a soft deadline for that?
I'm gonna keep these two conversations separate. So the first point is that for enhancement freeze, it kept opt-in late. They don't have a lot of time to go back and forth with to response to us. It's been a while since I do this. Do we have a PRR deadline still?
Yes, but it's not well adhered to.
That's okay.
Yeah.
My response to this is that the point of the PRR deadline is that if you don't opt in by the PRR deadline, we don't have enough time to get back to you. And it is going to be a perennial problem that folks opt in last minute, no matter what kind of soft deadline we have. So I might be cynical, but to me, this is just one of those things that is like best effort. We try and get people to opt in before PRR. For the PRR team's sake and for our sake, and if they don't, we try our best.
Also, it might be issue for the first release of the year, because normally it's after we start early in January and people are not get back to work. Maybe we could see that as part of when we are scheduling the whole release. Maybe, I'm not sure.
Yeah, we did start pretty early. But I'm not quite sure if there's like an action item in here. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, even I don't have a concrete action item right now. It's just that something.
I agree with you. It's a valid issue of like we feel like we haven't given folks enough time to like update the things, and if they update the things, they need to like PR and approve it. But yeah, this might be one of those things that's just like is the way it is.
I think this is just like a cultural issue within the project that I'm not sure we can like process out of the way. Unfortunately, okay. Yeah.
All right. There's no action item here. I will be moving on to Muhammad's point about a soft deadline for exception request after freeze event. I also have opinions here. Sorry, lots of opinions used to do enhancement. I wrote in the exception request MD that the longer it takes for you to file, the harder it is for us to accept it. And you know, that's just the way it is. I wonder, Mohammed, like what does the soft deadline here looks like to you? Is it
I was mainly thinking about, for instance, something saying that maybe after 3 days, tops, it would be 3 days after each freeze event, for instance.
I think that's a fair number. Like if it's more than 3 days, very not likely to gonna get accepted. What do you think about that, Kat?
I like it personally, because I agree. You should not be sending in exception requests a full week and a half after the freeze. That's just not okay. So I very much support a 3 day deadline. We can't implement that this release, but I would like to see it in 131.
Okay. Can I get an owner to put this into the exception request MD?
I will already be working in it for that enhancements issue, so you can throw it at me.
Fantastic. Thank you. And where was I?
Can I add one item here at the end? Because I just noticed there's one item I forgot.
Go for it.
Okay.
Drew is not here, so I'm gonna read out his item. After having added Google Calendars for Doc Sub Team that include the update meetings, one consequence is having encouraged an on-call culture rather than active engagement. So on one hand, this is divided responsibilities, nice work-life balance and tracking, essentially for a busy working professional, but also hurts redundancy and makes shadow engagement for more difficult to dodge. Yeah, interesting. Drew's not here. Does anyone has any thoughts on this?
I can provide a little bit of thought since we did this when I ran docs as well. It makes it considerably easier for shadows to remember that it's their job to provide the update that week, or their job to update the doc. But I did find that it made people who were not assigned to the meeting less likely to actually attend the meeting. And I prefer that all of my shadows attend all of the meetings that they do not have a direct conflict with personally. So I don't know that there's actually an action item there, unfortunately. I think that is just an issue of how you manage your team. And it comes down to the sub team lead to ensure that their shadows are actually attending the meetings rather than just doing exactly what's assigned to them. It is a useful thing to have, but the sub team lead has to convince their shadows that they need to be attending the meetings, whether they're assigned to give the update or not.
Yeah, you mentioned this in the meeting we have right before this, Kat, but attending the weekly meeting is part of the job, whether you're speaking or not. So unless you have direct conflict, or it's a time zones issues, please, please make sure you attend. Mohammed, I see that you're typing. Take your time and share whenever. You're muted, by the way, Mohammed.
I was in the other page, sorry. We received a request to grant PR reviewers access to the tracking board. And we had a discussion regarding that. Maybe we need to update the access list with the proper group for them. I think We already discussed it in the sick release, I guess, with them. Also, when I was creating the tracking board with the automatic synchronization wasn't working because I didn't add the robot access by that time because it was not documented. We also need to update that.
Okay. I actually think that's what the next item is about. So you're right on time there. I'm just going to eat it right underneath this thing.
Awesome.
Okay, so PR shadows and just PR folks have their own GitHub group now, and it seems like we also need to grant robot access. So seems like this is going to be documentation so that we smooth this out for the next release. Can I get an order?
I'll do it if I gotta, but
no, perhaps an enhancement shadow.
Serum has an active PR to update those documentation I suggested there. Would you follow that up, Serum?
Yeah, I'll add the PR articles in the same PR.
Okay.
Okay, fantastic. I'm gonna put you down, Serum. Thank you. And let me finish my thought and type this out. Enhancement tracking board documentation. Fantastic. Anything else you want to add about this, Kat?
No, that pretty well covers it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hi, Adolfo. I'm just gonna paste what Adolfo says here. Adolfo is our friend in sick release leadership. Okay, and Kat, your next item.
Hello, yes. This was a request from SIG Docs. We did not know that we could ask them to enable deploy previews for the branch syncs. They can. We can't do it ourselves. The docs lead can't do it. But SIG Docs can. And I think that it would be a very useful thing to have. It makes it easier to spot issues that are not necessarily easy to spot when you're just combing through code. That is a handbook update, basically. That's a thing that we want to document that the docs lead should ask SIG Docs to do. It's just a switch they flip at the beginning of the release and flip off at the end.
All right. Any owners from docs? I might have to, or I will assign this to Drew.
Yeah, just to Drew.
Okay. Awesome. And Drew has the next couple. Do you have any context on this, Kat, or should I just read it on bigger?
I do because I just did this. So SIG Docs asked the docs subteam at the end of last release to start explicitly tracking documentation targeting the dev branch, whether it is associated with a new feature or not. And that means adding it to the tracking board. When you add it to the tracking board, even if it's just on the docs tab, it will also show up on the enhancements tab in another place, which can make tracking for the enhancements team a little bit messy because this doesn't look like a feature to them. So I added a type of docs to the enhancements tab so that the enhancements team can filter that out and not have to look at it or take it into account. I think that should just be added to the way the board is set up. And that makes it easier for the docs team to track the things we're being asked to track and the enhancements to not track the things that they don't have to track. So it's just another documentation change to the docs handbook and to the enhancements handbook.
So I'm going to put this down for Drew and then he can reassign it if he would like under docs. So incorporate dark side videos and tracking board. And then Mohammed, which you or anyone on your team would like to take on that side of the board?
I can do that.
Okay, thank you. Hopefully I spelled your name right. Awesome. And Drew and Viom has two things here. Viom, are you around or is it too late?
Yes, I am.
Hello.
Hey, everyone. So the point that we're discussing over here is about automated branchings. So right now we have to manually do branchings once a week, and the CLA bot was, you know, not working properly. So we had to do it twice a week. So we shouldn't be doing branchings at the first place. If there are conflicts, then that's a separate issue, but I think we can automate this process that a bot performs branching. I think the release management team has a tool that does something like that, and we can integrate that in the website repository. So that's about this point.
Release management does indeed have a tool to fast forward a branch. It has been modified to work in repos other than KK. So that is the tool you want to be using.
Cool, so you can assign this item to me, I'll take care of this. And the next item that we were discussing is that potentially this may be important in a longer time period, that we want to automate pinging folks about deadlines and stuff on Slack and GitHub. But my personal views on this is that we shouldn't be doing this, because people get used to getting messages from bots and they just ignore it. For example, if I get a GitHub notification from the KHCI bot, I would only personally check that when I'm working on the issue or the PR. But other than that, they just pile up and people tend to miss them. And if an actual person tags me, then I would check out what that person is saying. So, you know, I'm in double minds over here. So any clarity on this issue? Anybody has any opinions? Whether we want to automate pinging folks about deadlines.
I mean, the question here is, is the automation worth the effort?
Personally, it's a no for me. And the reason for that is that this was my first time in the DocSub team. And when I was sending messages whether docs is required or not, I went through the CAP. I analyzed the CAP. If there's a feature gate that needs to be bumped up, then definitely a docs PR is required. So I did that thing. I analyzed the CAP. So according to me, whether the docs PR was required or not, if it was completely clear that a docs PR was required, I explicitly mentioned that I'm marking this as need docs and please open a docs placeholder PR right now. So I think this process should stay with humans rather than taking over bots. So that's my take on this.
Okay. If no one else has a differing opinion, I think it's an interesting thought of whether we should automate things, and that's always important to consider, but doesn't seem like it would be useful in this case. So there's no plus for automation. We keep our jobs and move on to the next point. Paco and Neil.
Yeah, so this point is about the feedback we received in this release signal retro. So Shadow said that a few points weren't clear to them about how the rule functions. So the release signal handbook right now, it's quite lengthy, I'll admit that. But nobody likes reading lengthy handbooks. So we should try to deliver the information in bite-sized chunks, maybe through videos or flowcharts. So some enhancements over there in the release signal handbook, we can definitely improve that. We have these explicit points mentioned where we want to improve that in the CI signal retro doc. Maybe I can add a link after the meeting or maybe right now. So these specific points are in that doc, but we would definitely want to improve the release signal handbook and maybe add a few videos demonstrating how to actually work with Qiskit dashboards or how to diagnose flakes and stuff like that. So there are a few videos, but they are like 3 years old or a year old. Maybe we want to update them. Maybe we want to use those videos only so that we can decide.
I know Laura has some. Are you talking about those? Or are you talking about
Laura also has some, but there are some videos from the 1.20 release as well. It's a 1 hour long video that takes you through the whole role. And I watched that video when I was first introduced to CI Signal in 1.27. And I think that video covers the stuff well enough that anybody can understand that. And the CI Signal team has, of course, progressed a lot, but the core functioning of the team remains the same. So those videos should technically work. But sometimes folks are like, it's a three-year-old video. Would this be up to date? So that dilemma can be there, but I think they work pretty well.
Okay, and I definitely agree that the CI Signal portion of the handbook is quite monstrous. The videos would help the training. Any thoughts on this, Kat?
I generally find videos to be very helpful. The docs sub team uses them for things like branch syncs, and there are recordings for the release day activities that I personally leaned on very heavily. So I like the idea of recording training videos. It feels better to watch somebody else actually go through the process for some people. It's how I prefer to be taught something. Not everybody is the same, so I think we still need to maintain both, but.
Okay, I think a good action item out of this is maybe we can just compile all the videos together, put it in a playlist, link it into the release signal handbook. Vium, would you be a good person to assign this to?
Yes, sure, assign this to me.
Fantastic.
But I'll need someone to like work on the Kubernetes channel, like create a playlist and stuff like that.
We can get access to that for you.
Cool.
Yeah.
There's another point after this. So that point is about the on-call thing that goes in CI Signal. It's not working. I've seen this happening from 1.27. It only works when the shadows are really motivated to do their jobs and they check the Qiskit dashboards daily. But like docs, we mentioned on-call in docs also, people only perform actions when they're assigned to. And if the shadows are not that invested in the team and they just want to perform their duties, then this does not work well. So we want to remove this term on-call from CI Signal altogether and move this team away from the on-call culture. So that's the point over here. Like foster a culture where the shadows should observe the Qiskit dashboards daily. It hardly takes 5 to 10 minutes, and progressively, if you're observing a dashboard daily, you know what tests are failing, what tests are flaking. So, I mean, it can pretty much done in 5 minutes daily if you do that. So move the team away from this culture. So this is something that the team, maybe we should document this as well in the handbook for the lead, like don't create Excel sheets to explicitly assign shadows to for certain weeks. And yeah, something can be done over here, maybe in the handbook or maybe while training new shadows.
How do we do this to ensure that there's coverage throughout the day? And also that people don't feel like they have to be on all the time.
I definitely feel that nobody would feel that they have to be on all the time. If the teams, usually the teams are divided across multiple time zones. So if everyone takes responsibility to check the Qiskit dashboards in their prime time zone or their prime working hours, then I think this would work. I don't see a problem, why not?
Have we done this in a previous release?
No, we haven't, because we didn't feel the need to do something like this, because CI Signal was like going pretty well, because it's about how motivated the shadows are or how well they understand the process. So if there are gaps over there, then this is a like this is the weakest link that would break first. So we have to fix this. And one thing I was thinking over here is that maybe for a few releases, till this culture is set in the team, we can get maybe have the shadows fill in some weekly doc stating what they observed in the dashboard or any problems they're having till we solidify this practice. Would that be too much? But I'm not sure about that. Like having shadows fill maybe a doc or an Excel sheet weekly, what they observe, if they have any doubts, like daily like feedback cycle that we can create between the lead and the shadows.
Can I suggest simply holding a stand-up, a weekly team stand-up for that purpose?
That might work, but usually when, let's say we send out the doodle for onboarding meeting, a few shadows aren't able to join even after we have a full doodle.
Sure, yeah.
Time zones. So I stand-ups, they can work if the time zones are appropriate and folks are free, but they do not work in all the cases, that's what I'll say. But if somebody is doing that asynchronously on their end, then I think it can work in the docs update.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Based on what you said, Guillaume, I think a sheet to report what they observe might be a little bit much. Maybe just like a log of like when people last checked in to the grid to make sure that like people have checked in and there's a continuous flow. Because even if we do this, I'm trying to understand like if there are shadows who doesn't check in, how do we ensure that like that's not a point of failure and we don't know who responsibility it was to look at the test grid. Does
so,
that make sense?
The idea that I have with this is that we'll still have a primary observer, but we won't use different terms that don't make it sound obvious that that person would be primarily observing the dashboard. I haven't coined up a term yet, but we would come up with something. And with just simply adding in a logbook when you checked in the last, when you checked in the test grid dashboard, I mean, that's pretty easy to fake. I mean, anybody can just enter, oh, I checked it just like 2 hours ago. But if we ask them, you checked it, what did you find in the test grid dashboard? So that the lead has some verification, some sort of verification over what their shadows are doing. So that's my point. That's my take with this.
I think sure you can fake the log, but if you fake the log and there was a failure and you didn't catch it, I think it would have been very obvious that you didn't.
And that's a dead giveaway if somebody does that.
Yeah. The other thing is like I didn't fully understand your thoughts before this, but like if we're still gonna have one person.
Yeah, we'll still have someone who's primarily assigned, but
yeah,
the term like primary observer, it makes the feel like, oh, not their turn to do the tasks.
Right. It seems like only that person is responsible when it's just like the whole team comes together to provide coverage. Okay, I understand. Do we is this something we want to try right now, Kat?
Ship it, yeah.
Fantastic. All right. Guillaume, do you have anything you want to coin this term to be, or we can come up with that later? But it seems like we're going to start doing this right now, which is the point of a mid-cycle retro, really.
What we should call the person that's watching the test dashboard. I'll think about this and I'll update in the release via single channel or in the SIG release or in person DMs, but I'll think about this.
Okay, sounds good. I think that action item is in progress starting now. And I'm just going to put down a note to just check in with that. And after we do it, make sure we have documentation. So and obviously, work with Paco on this to update the shadows and what this potentially will look like. Fantastic, everyone. We are 10 minutes early. Any last minute items? If not, the folks who have action items have been assigned, and I will check in with you at the end of cycle retro about these. If you start on them, finish them, please add a status. And that is all. All right, everyone, have a good rest of your day, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Bye, y'all. Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks,
everyone.